Bom dia a todos, bem-vindos à reunião geral do Departamento de Psiquiatria da Faculdade dos Hospitais Clínicos da Faculdade de Medicina da Universidade de São Paulo. Hoje nós temos uma convidada muito especial falando na nossa reunião geral online. É a artista Viviane Silveira, nascida em Hong Kong, morou em São Paulo por 5 anos e atualmente mora e trabalha em Nova York, com um trabalho que explora o tema da memória e do estresse pós-traumático. Ela vai falar hoje um pouco sobre a experiência dela e sobre o percurso dela. Ela fez um curta em 2016, que chama See Memory, em que ela trabalhou em mais de 10 mil pinturas e conversou com diversos neurocientistas, incluindo o Eric Kandel. E aí ela vai contar um pouco da experiência dela para a gente. E depois, o Dr. Felipe Corks, médico assistente e colaborador aqui do Departamento de Psiquiatria, vai comentar a apresentação. Perguntas são bem-vindas no chat e bem-vindas à nossa apresentação. Boa apresentação a todos. Thank you, Viviane. You can start whenever you want.
Okay, thank you. I'm so thrilled to be here. I love Brazil. I love my childhood in Brazil. It's so great to reconnect with the University of São Paulo. I'm going to start my screen share now. So I'm just going to talk about how, as an artist, I started to collaborate with psychiatrists and neuroscientists in my work, and how my conversations and interviews with neuroscientists and psychiatrists completely changed the direction of my work, and how the science of memory has, you know, seeing memory through the lens of art has been such a transformative experience. I'm just going to take you straight inside my studio. This is a project I'm working on right now. It's called Feel Memory. It's actually going to be a limited TV series. And I'm working with interviewing scientists and people who have struggled with memory. And we're going to look at both the personal experience of memory and the latest developments in the science of memory in this series. So these are paintings that I'm currently working on, and each painting will become an animation for the characters' memories. And I'll go into more detail a little bit later. So I actually started studying painting in Brazil with a painter, Roberto d'Oliveira, in his studio, in his atelier in São Paulo when I was about 11 or 12 years old, and just fell in love with it. But when I moved to New York when I was 15, I sort of dropped it, and I really fell in love with film and wanted to go into filmmaking, but I didn't have my green card yet. It took me a long time to get my green card. So after college, where I had studied cognitive psychology, I ended up going to art school and falling in love with sculpture and focusing for many years on sculpture. And here you can see, you know, I was making large scale sculpture and ended up doing a commission for the Women's Studies Department at Vanderbilt University. It was a very long process, and this was, you know, I had to work with engineers and landscape architects and present maquettes and sort of go through this whole committee. And after the whole process, I decided that it was very frustrating not to be able to move my own work because the bronze is very heavy and sort of needed help just to get the clay to a foundry. And I decided I wanted to continue to work very large, but to be able to work large completely on my own. So here you can, I switched to making these large scale drawings. And I love that I could just roll them up and carry them with me. I didn't need anyone else's help. And I did, the drawings are about 7 feet by 5 feet. So, you know, over life size, but the opposite of sculpture, very, very lightweight. And at this point, I was interested in linking contemporary art to art history and thinking about human perception and human behavior, but not specifically yet about memory. Then in 2007, my first daughter was born. And that's really what started me down the memory road. I was reading parenting books about, you know, what to talk to your children about. And they said, you know, share your childhood memories with your children because it helps to build self-esteem. It's really important to know where they come from and it makes them feel secure. And I realized that I had a lot of trouble accessing my earliest memories of my childhood in Hong Kong. Everything seemed very blurry and out of focus and out of reach. And I would remember sort of flashes of images, maybe a sensation, a feeling, but I had trouble putting something together that I could put into words. And my brother and sister, who are only 2 and 3 years older than me, here we are, this is a drawing I made for a series called Borrowed Memory. They had very clear memories of Hong Kong and they would tell stories. And when I heard their stories, I thought, oh, maybe I kind of remember that. But for the most part, they were describing something that I had no access to if they didn't tell me about it. And I began to feel very frustrated, where are these memories? I lived there for 10 years. You know, where are the memories of Hong Kong? And I decided to do a series in my art called Borrowed Memory. So I lived in Hong Kong in the 70s to the early 80s. And I decided to take all of my family photographs and then also look on the internet at other people's photographs from the 1970s in Hong Kong and to see if I could fill in the empty spaces in my memory bank in mind, pictures, these memory pictures. And thought maybe the way to fill in the missing images. And I called it borrowed memory. It was literally borrowing people's family photographs and my own. This is my own photograph. And that might represent the color of memory. And I had a dream. This is called a junk. Boat water, and you see them a lot in Hong Kong. I many little family snapshots of these junks on water, and I had dreamed in New York as an adult that I'm on a junk floating down the water, on the ship that I was sailing by, so life, and I could stop at the ship. Visit a memory on the shore. And I chose not to. In my dream, I chose to just keep going down the water without stopping to visit the memories. And I realized that I was afraid to know what was there. This is the first drawing in the series. I did all the drawings on colored paper. And this is the last drawing in the series. So I decided at a certain point that I was not going to allow myself to use anything but white pencil to draw, so that I would have to create all the values from light to dark in white, which was going to be a real challenge, but also a lot of fun. And I would say that I started out wanting my memories to be very clear and sharp and in focus, like in this picture. And I ended here with this very blurry, cross-hatched, complicated layering of memory. And in a way, you know, my drawings were telling me that it was not going to be that easy to unravel memory and all of a sudden put memories into focus, because this is the image that I arrived at the end of the whole process of the series. After that, my second child was born, and I knew that I wanted to continue exploring memory visually. And I thought, okay, where do I go from here? And I thought, okay, well, therapists deal with memory, probably more than anyone in their work. So why don't I visit some therapist offices and take photographs and maybe make paintings from those photographs? Well, after visiting therapist offices here in New York, I realized that it was quite boring to have an office without people in it. And that what made the therapy office so fascinating was the human drama, the people exploring their memories in it. And at the time, there was a TV series on HBO, it called In Treatment. And it was about a therapist played by Gabriel Byrne. And each episode was a session with a patient he was treating. And I was completely absorbed in their memories, their stories. It was really riveting. And so I started to examine the way they lit the scenes, the way they designed the scenes, and realized that the therapy office was very dark, like a cave. And then you had these very bright lights just outside in the windows. But there were a lot of shadows, a lot of cast shadows, a lot of silhouettes. And I thought this was very representative of how when you're talking about memory, it becomes more real. The memory becomes more real or more vivid than your actual physical world. And that the shadows and the darkness, when the character was speaking about their memories, created this very, you were able to enter their mental landscape, and the physical real world seemed to really fall away. So I became really fascinated between the light and with the light and the shadows and the contrast between this light and dark and how the mental landscape becomes so vivid when you're entering the character's world in this way. Another film I looked at was the film Ordinary People. It's directed by Robert Redford. I think it came out in 1980 or 81. And I think it's one of the most brilliant films ever made. And it is the story of a boy who's a teenage boy whose brother has died in a boating accident, and he was with him, and somehow he survived. And his brother was the stronger swimmer. So when we first meet him, he is suicidal, and he doesn't really understand his behavior. He's very anxious, he's having nightmares, he's having flashbacks. And what begins to unfold is we realize that he has some kind of survivor's guilt, that his brother was really the star, his brother was the stronger swimmer. How come he lived and his brother died? And the therapy scenes were quite fascinating because when we first meet him and he has no access to his subconscious. The subconscious is intruding on his world in flashes, but he's not able to put anything into words. And he first goes to this therapist's office. There are no shadows. He's lit from a fluorescent lighting. He's holding his bag, his backpack in front of him. He's very guarded. And as he enters the therapy relationship with the Dr. Berger here, the scenes become darker and darker. You don't have overhead lighting anymore. You have one or two light sources. You have a lot of contrast between light and shadow. And I decided in this series to only use one or two colors. So here you can see I'm using warm and cool contrasting colors. And here really just one color with the white. And the reason why I wanted to do this is I didn't want to just paint a representation, you know, of a film still. I really wanted to eliminate color because color can sometimes confuse light and shadow. And I thought if I eliminated color, it would become all about the light and the shadow, and also all about the body language. So here, you know, he's entered his inner world of emotion and memory, and he looks exhausted. And the doctor is looking at him, you know, trying to think of a way to reach him. And all of the objects in the office, like here, you see these shadows. They almost feel like, you could invent what these shadows mean. They feel like a Rorschach test or something. So I just thought it creates such a sense of mystery. And by as he relaxes into the therapy, it becomes darker and darker. And by the time the climax of his inner journey, there's almost no light. There's just a street lamp from outside when he is in the memory of his brother's death. And then we as the audience are in the memory with him completely and not aware of his physical surroundings. After that, I wanted to continue to look at movies to see the way cinematographers, directors visually told the story of the mind, memory, the subconscious. And so I looked at a film called The King's Speech. It's with the actors Colin Firth and Jeffrey Rush. And here I became less interested in the relationship between patient and therapist. This is a story of King George, who had a stutter, and the therapist who helped him treat him for his stutter. And in all of these images, I started the paintings with the therapist and the patient. So actually the therapist is standing here in the actual scene. And I ended up painting the therapist out. Also, there were bars on the window, which you can see a little bit. And I painted the bars out because I became more and more fascinated with how do you visually portray the subconscious? And I started to have the light drip in to the inside, to the room. And I realized I was starting to think of the light as water. And I had remembered when I had been in therapy when I was in college and I had had a dream that I was swimming underwater. I remember my therapist telling me water is a symbol of the subconscious. So that means you're sort of swimming around in your subconscious. And ever since then, I've thought visually of sort of being submerged in water as entering the dreamlike world or the subconscious world. This is another painting from the same series, from the same film. And in this one, the therapist is standing here, and there was a chair here. I ended up painting it out. And I became, again, just very interested with the inner world versus the outer world of the main character. So the king is sitting here, and he's very uptight. His shoulders are very boxy. And he's sort of folding in on himself. But the wall behind him is swirling with these colors. And I realized as I was painting it that the wall was really showing us the inner turmoil that, you know, he could not express. So I was learning a lot from all of these cinematographers and directors and the way they brought us into the characters' worlds and their emotions and their memories and their struggles. But at this point, I realized that I did not want to use anyone else's images. I had learned so much about these beautiful compositions and beautiful lighting, and I wanted to challenge myself and make all the images, even the raw materials, on my own. So I had actually read an article in the New York Times Book Review by the neurologist Oliver Sacks, and it was called Speak Memory. And it was about his relationship to memory, memories he had as a child that he wrote about in books and later realized were not his memories, but his brother's memory. For example, of being in London during the Blitz, during the Second World War, and describing it so vividly. And then his brother said, "That was me. You were in the countryside. I wrote you a letter about it." And so he talked about how emotions are the strongest encoder of memory, and how we all borrow memories, how memory melds with imagination, with the stories we hear, and how neurologically it's impossible to decipher an imagined memory from an experienced memory, that it looks the same. And I became completely fascinated by this. I also realized that Oliver Sacks' article, Speak Memory, was borrowed from Nabokov's memoir, Speak Memory. And so I decided that since I was a visual artist, that I was going to do this project called See Memory, that I was going to explore the visual world of memory. So that's where the title came from. And I got two actors, one to play a therapist and one to play the patient. And we started with this conference room that I staged as a therapy room. And I copied the arc from Ordinary People, that there's a young girl, she's struggling with her memories and she doesn't see things clearly and she doesn't understand her own memories. And she goes to a therapist, and over time, through the connection with the therapist, is able to face her memories, and she's no longer alone. She's no longer isolated. She now has a witness to her memories, and they are no longer too difficult for her to look at. At this point, I was really still working as a painter, not as a film director, in that I was directing the models as models, you know, stand here, look this way. I wasn't really directing them so much for the story. And here you can see me filming in the room with the actors. And we also filmed in Central Park on a very snowy, snowy day. We shot in the winter. You can see the snow outside here. And I realized that the film was very overexposed. It was very bright and it wasn't really usable as a film, as film footage. And so I sort of sat with it for a while, not sure what to do with it. And then I realized, oh, I will just use this footage as raw material. So I can improve the footage in my paintings. I can add color and contrast in the paintings. So I decided to turn the film into my paintings and then turn the paintings back into film. So it would start out as a film and then turn back into painting. So here you see me painting one of the scenes in my studio. And I'm gonna just share with you a few of the stop motion animations from this without any of the narration. I decided for the narration, I was gonna interview therapists and neuroscientists to form the voiceover. And I got to interview some really incredible people, including Daniela Schiller at Mount Sinai, who did a lot of work on memory reconsolidation, and Eric Kandel, who, you know, obviously made some of the most groundbreaking discoveries in that he was able to show the actual biological formation of a memory in a sea slug. And I interviewed a doctor who taught narrative medicine about storytelling and medicine. And I wove all the interviews together to form the narration for this piece, which, as Marina said, you can see on Amazon Video. So I'm not going to show an excerpt from the film. I'm just going to show some of the animations. So I wanted to show an example. This is a film still, and it turns into this painting. This is the final state of the painting. And the painting process really changed for me through my interviews with psychiatrists and neuroscientists, because I started out painting very straightforwardly from these stills. And I talked to Dr. Elvav at Columbia University, and he said, you know, painting is very much like dreaming, in that when you have a dream, it's the interpretation of the dream that tells you the most about yourself. It's not the dream itself. So he said, in the same way with a painting can be anything, and it's what you say about the painting, the story you tell about the painting, that is telling you about what's going on in your subconscious. So I thought that was just such a beautiful insight into the process of painting. And so I decided that while I was painting, I was going to try and dream paint. So my canvas is on the wall, and then I walk back to the camera to take a picture, and I make a walk back to the wall to make another stroke on the canvas. And I decided that I wouldn't know what I was going to do next. I would just let my subconscious take over and just do a stroke, walk to the camera, walk back to the painting, do another stroke and see what happened. And in this painting, I really felt very stuck when I was just painting the room as it was. And when I started to paint Central Park right there, I knew I wanted the girl to leave the therapy room and walk back into Central Park. And when I started to just let her walk straight out the window into the park, my energy started to flow again. And I started to feel like I could breathe again. And I realized that if I was stuck in a painting, it meant I was not following my intuition. And so if I followed my intuition, if I followed my subconscious, then the painting could resolve itself. So it was my biggest challenge was getting my conscious out of the way of my subconscious while I was not asleep, but actually awake. That was my biggest challenge. And I found if I could do that, then everything would fall into place. So I'm going to show a couple of examples of the moving paintings here. So this actually opens and closes the film. Let's see. So that's just a little excerpt, and I will show a couple more so you get a sense of how the paintings come to life. Sorry. that's not quite the cropping that it's supposed to be in that one. And then I'll just show you one. And you see some of the primitive aspects of it. Sense of the how the painting started to move and come to life. And then after I showed it at some film festivals, the Imagine Science Film Festival, I also got a chance to install some of the moving paintings in universities and various places. So they sort of became standalone moving paintings. Like this. And I knew that, you know, I didn't want to go back to just painting alone in my studio. I had really fallen in love with the collaborative process, working with musicians and sound designers and the neuroscientists and the psychiatrists. And I just really loved now having a community of people who were fascinated by memory, and each of us looking at memory through their own discipline, but very much asking the same questions. And, you know, the neuroscience really opened up a window in my mind of wonder and imagination and just recognizing the power of the mind. So I knew I wanted to continue working with other people and to continue to learn about the science of memory and continue to talk to more scientists. And I decided that the next project would be called Feel Memory. I had done an interview with Daniela Schiller for See Memory. And I had talked about my frustration with my lack of memory of my childhood in Hong Kong. And she pointed out to me that I had a very narrow definition of what memory was, that I was saying memory had to be a story you could tell, something you put into words. But she said, you know, memory can be a feeling, it can be a mood, it can be a smell, you know, that you have more memory than you think. And she also said, your behavior is your memory. The way you behave tells me, you know, everything that has ever happened to you. And when she pointed out that behavior is memory, it really sort of blew my mind. Of course, it made sense and was something I knew, and it seemed so simple. But when she put it that way, it really opened up this whole new world that I wanted to explore. So I decided, rather than see memory, smell memory, touch memory, the new project will be called Feel Memory, because it would encompass all sensations, all different ways of experiencing memory. And so the project took many years to find its form. I started out by going to the Montreal Neurological Institute And having a chance with Silvana Reggio, this neurologist psychiatrist at Mount Sinai, who became a good friend and was also in C-Memory, was good friends with Brenda Milner and had authored some papers and books with her. So we got to go when Brenda Milner was 98, 99. So this was 2016. She's now 102 and still working. And to film an interview with her at the Montreal Neurological Institute. And I love this. She worked with Penfield, and she, of course, did the seminal work on patient HM, the man that they took the hippocampus out of and realized then that long-term memory was stored in the hippocampus because he could no longer form long-term memories. So this was on location in the Montreal Neurological Institute, filming with Brenda Milner. And at this point, I was just gathering information, just saying, okay, I have an opportunity to meet with this brilliant scientist. Let me go ahead and talk to them. I also visited Karim Nader, who discovered memory reconsolidation with Joseph Ledeux in, I think, 99. And also, you know, was very groundbreaking, the whole idea that memories were once stored into long-term memory were not permanent, that when you recall a memory during the period of recollection, the memory can become flexible and can be changed. And so I also interviewed him at McGill University and got a chance to visit his lab. He runs his own lab there. I meant to include a photo. I'm sorry I didn't hear. And then speaking with Daniela Schiller, who was an advisor on the project, talking about the fact that, you know, this project should be very much focused on people, how memory affects people in their most personal, intimate lives, and that the science should inform it, but should not be the whole story or necessarily even the main story, because it's really how the science affects us that makes it so relevant. So I spent another couple of years searching for main characters, people who had struggles with memory that they were kind of trying to come to terms with. And this time I was going to use both live action footage and the animations. And the painted animations were to portray their memories, things that we couldn't film. And so I met this writer, Victoria. She had a very moving story that she had written about when she was only 21 in the New York Times, about her father who came out as gay and HIV positive when she was 4 years old, and 7 years later died of AIDS-related suicide. And she had also written a memoir years before, but we sat down to do some interviews, and she gave me all of her materials, letters, notes, tapes, and started to talk about her relationship with memory and how the fact that she spent so much time with her father when she was a little girl, but she felt like the memory added up to nothing. She felt her memory was fragmented. She didn't know what the whole picture was because her father had lived such a hidden life. And she didn't, she said she could not know who she was until she put together the pieces of who her father was and make sense of who he was to her and their time together. So this is, she's one of the main characters in the first episode of this series. And so in my studio, you can see this is me in my studio, and these are all paintings of Victoria's story and newspaper clippings and sort of every piece of artifact that she gave me. And I read the transcripts and we become very close, talk about her dreams, her imagination, her memories. She has this tape that her father, two tapes her father made when he was 21 years old that has his voice on it. And with all of those materials, I sort of storyboard what her story is going to be and then figure out which memory sequences I have to create. So I thought I would share with you a very short clip, rough clip of the early stages of the process of Victoria's story. Just to set it up, her father, when she was 8 years old, had promised her a trip around the world. And he obviously never got a chance to take her on that trip. And they were supposed to go to Cambodia to see Angkor Wat because he was an architect and he really wanted to see the temples. They were supposed to go to Stockholm where he had been a student when he was 21 years old and to go to Paris where she wanted to go. He never got to take her there. So she takes this trip herself when she's about 23, 24 years old. And she thinks that she is going to find a piece of her father in each place that will sort of bring him back to her. And she does in Cambodia and in Stockholm. She finds, you know, fragments of his life story that helps her put her memory together. But Paris is a huge disappointment. And so I'm going to show you the Paris clip, the beginning of the Paris clip.
In Paris, there was sort of nothing else ahead. There was no next stop. This was it. When my father had presented me with the idea of this trip and had asked me where I wanted to go, I had come up with Paris. It was very much my idea and my dream. As a kid, you know, just the idea of Paris, it felt just magical. As I got older and read more and saw more movies and listened to more music, I just thought, this is going to be incredible. This is going to be wonderful.
That's for me.
Had this notion that Paris was going to be my dad. If my father had been a city, it would have been Paris. He was French. He loved French food. He loved French wine. His style and manner of dress had always sort of skewed European. I found that that was true. I do think that if my father had been a city, he would have been Paris. All of that was there, but my father's weaknesses also seemed to be present in Paris, and they felt very stark to me because I was searching for my father and assumed that we would be there together. The city felt very cold and aloof to me. It was holding me at arm's length. It was like my dad. It was too much like my dad. And that made it painful. I feel lost in this old city, haunted. It is a beautiful place, but I can't help thinking how incredible it would have been to see it with my father, to have him show me Paris. He would have loved eating the morning soft boiled egg from a porcelain egg cup. He would have approved of the French talent for lingering over meals and the way Parisians make lingering feel like a respectable activity. Every bridge, every baguette, every park is a reminder of what he didn't show me. of what we didn't do together. For all those years, I'd sort of held Paris aloft in my mind, and I'd protected it. And now I was there. And I couldn't protect it anymore. It wasn't aloft, it was in my hand. And someone popped the balloon, popped the dream. In Paris, I tried to summon the sound of my father's voice.
Do you smile to tempt a lover, Mona Lisa? Or is this your way to hide a broken heart?
I tried to hear him there beneath the Eiffel Tower.
Have been brought to your doorstep. They just lie there.
Memories are like colors. They can be beautiful on their own, but they're so much more when they're used to make a painting. But what good is painting a painting if the person you want most to see it never will?
Made actually a couple of years ago, and we are in a very different stage now. Hang on, let me just find where my presentation went. Here we go. And so it's taken new forms, but the process of painting remains the same. Here you can see a still where she's standing at the window, and then I'm sort of imagining how I'm going to show her father being elusive in Paris. So here's a still from one of the animations. This is one, we went to Columbia University to visit it together because she went there for undergrad and graduate school. And Victoria had told me that when she was a kid, she used to ride a unicycle. And so I'll show you how that sort of came into my consciousness while I was painting in this sequence over here. So this is very rough, no sound, no music. This is how the paintings develop. And I would rarely show the painting from start to finish in any film or project. It takes me a long time as I'm painting to figure out where I'm going with it and to get to the part that's going to be interesting or relevant to the story. So if a painting goes on for several minutes, I probably would only use 15 seconds, maybe 30 seconds of the entire painting in that final story. But here you can see, you know, I decided she was going to turn around as I'm painting it, and that the sky was going to get darker. And I'm thinking, I'm doing that thing with the one stroke at a time. And then she sort of appears on her unicycle on the right-hand side. And then I guess I was thinking about my memories, and I remembered the movie E.T. and the bike, you know, in the sky. So it became her unicycle in the sky. And this is the way, this is where it has ended up right now. I don't know if I will continue this or not. Probably I will have maybe the, that's an example, one of them. So we then went to, opposed to Victoria, what if we do a what if sequence? So her father died when he was 44 of age-related suicide. He had died, it was a relief because he had been suffering so much for so many years. And her grief for her father went back much further than his death to what could have been. What if he had been able to live as an openly gay man without fear or sickness? What if he had never gotten AIDS? What would he have done with his life? What would he have created? He was an architect, he painted, he sculpted. And so I had been reading about the work by Daniel Kahneman, the psychologist who won the Nobel Prize for, I guess, behavioral economics. And he had done a study about what happens when people are stricken by grief and the way people's minds coped with loss. This is his words, by drifting onto fantasy paths where loss never occurred. So in his own life, he had had a nephew in the Israeli army who I think a week or two before he was supposed to be done with his service was on a practice flight in a plane. And the pilot got blinded by flare and thought he was flying the plane up, but was actually flying the plane down and dove straight into the ground. And his nephew died. I think he was only about 23 years old. And he noticed at the funeral that all the family members who were so devastated, himself included, were going back and saying, what if he hadn't gone in that day? What if he had been able to alert the pilot about the flare and the pilot could have corrected his course? But no one said, what if there was no Israeli army? So he did a study to see how far back people were willing to go to go through these what if, or if only this hadn't happened. And he did it, I think, about with some scenarios about 9/11 here in New York. And it made me think, you know, can you heal a wound, a memory wound, with your imagination? What if you imagine what you wished had happened but never got to happen? What if you took control of your memory and used the flexibility of memory and that the fact that we meld our memories with stories and imagination anyway? What if you just took that one step further and did it very deliberately? So I asked Victoria what her father would have, what was the life she imagined for her father? Now that she's in her mid-30s, he would have been in his late 60s. And so she imagined him practicing architecture in London. So we went to London and I hired an actor who had the same build and looked like her father, or what her father might look like today. And we shot a whole what if sequence of her being his adult daughter, visiting him in London, visiting his offices. And in this sequence, she is remembering when she was a child, how she used to watch him breathe and how his breathing got more and more labored and how she always knew she had been told since she was 4 years old that he was going to die early. So these are some of the stills from that shoot. And this is me setting him up and she's watching him from the bench. And I wanted to just show you how this then turns into an animation that I'm working on right now. So again, this is unedited. This is the painting from start to finish. And as you can see, I just start painting very straightforwardly. And then I'm like, what would happen now? Okay, it's sort of like a resurrection, right? Her father, she's remembering his death. And then all of a sudden he comes back. So I'm imagining that here in a park in London. So there's the still that came from the film still. And then this is all imagined. We actually didn't film him standing up or doing any of this. This didn't come to me till, you know, months and months later, alone with the footage in my studio. And he stands up again, trying to paint from my subconscious. I guess it looks like a resurrection. And again, the sky turning from light to dark. And taking me a while to figure out what's going to happen. And eventually she comes to stand next to him. This has continued on since then. So you can see how the paintings are melding. Here's where we shot in this beautiful Richard Rogers building. It's called Wharf Studios in London. And this is a still from the actual footage we shot. This is sort of him waiting for her in the lobby of his office. And this is what it turns into in my imagination. And I will show you what that looks like in terms of the painting process. Again, in the final project, you won't see most of this. Cause I'm thinking, no, she's gonna walk towards him. Then I change my mind. She goes back, she's standing next to him. And then again, I start to think, how can I open up this space? How can I transform this through the painting process? There's no point in just rendering a painting that's a copy of what we've already filmed. So the painting, the animation has to do something that cannot be filmed, right? It has to just sort of, so it takes me a while to warm up and let my imagination take over again. That's probably the hardest part, sort of allowing myself to not paint reality, but to paint whatever comes to mind. And a lot of it, I realize, is letting the outside come in. I often feel stuck when I'm painting an interior, and it's only when the interior opens up and the exterior starts to come in that I start to feel like my energy start to flow and feel like it's really going somewhere. Here you see the bike riding. That was a big part of her childhood with him. So that's a still from that shoot of her watching him on the grass. And in this fantasy, she does say goodbye to him all over again. It ends with him or her saying goodbye to him now. What is it? How many years later? 20 something years later. And but this time she does it on her own terms. She's sort of lived out what might have been and hopefully taken some consolation in having a little glimmer of that experience. I recently shot some scenes in my studio of, you know, how we're going to put this all together in terms of melding my own memories with each character's memories. So I just wanted to show you some footage. None of this has been edited at all, but you can see, you know, the ways trying to be creative here with my cinematographer, take a small childhood snapshot and then project it onto these with three canvases. And you can see that it, a tiny snapshot gets completely transformed through these projections because the canvases are at different distances from the camera. So they each become their own tableau. And also, you know, trying to visually represent the sense of memory as fragments. How do you convey that? So trying to go beyond just the hand-painted animations, but exploring other ways to show the fragmentary nature of memory. So you can see we did that with the snapshots. Other things that we've done in the studio is my father actually grew up in Aleppo, Syria. And I managed to find this footage of the time he would have been there. And we did these projections of footage of Aleppo in the 40s with me standing in front of it in a white shirt so that the projection appears on my shirt. This is footage I found of Hong Kong in the 1970s. And here you can see we're projecting it on a ceiling and two corners, again, to visually convey the fragmentary nature of memory. So, you know, to be able to use visuals more than voiceover narration, you know, is the goal of film. So here you can see. And then just some of these really incredibly gorgeous shots on the curtains in my studio are some of my favorites. And you can see the stains on the curtain and the ripples on the curtain and how that does something to this very polished footage. And it gives us this sense of the memory. Also, you'll hear and sometimes see a train going by, the subway going by outside the window, sort of through the imagery. So this is where the project is now in terms of it, you know, taking it one step further from the archival and the animations, using a timeline to sort of piece together Victoria's story. And you can see me pasting the timeline and moving around the fragments of her story as I try and figure out how to tell her story and how to tell the story of the science of memory simultaneously. So there will be a neuroscientist helping me sort out each character's memory struggle. They will come to the studio, they will look at the fragments, and together we will uncover what is happening, you know, in the brain and what happens to each character, whether it's through PTSD or some other kind of memory interruption, and how the science can shine a light on that and help us decipher what's going on. These are some stills from the London shoot with Victoria, because I just, each character that I'm working with has really opened up a window for me in sharing their most private, most vulnerable experiences, and has, you know, this community of people invested in and fascinated by memory just has continued to grow and has really turned memory from something dark and difficult to something shared and really joyful. And, you know, again, this going, each of us being isolated with our own memory stories or experiences And starting to meld those stories together has been one of the greatest rewards that the community is, you know, continues to be growing. And even though this subject can be quite serious and sad, we're actually having a lot of fun working with it and transforming it, taking memories that haunt you and reanimating them. And in the reanimation, changing the tone and the emotion associated with the memory. I wanted to show you one of my biggest inspirations. I don't know if you know this book, Harold and the Purple Crayon, but it's a book I've been thinking about a lot. It's that the neuroscience, the illumination that I have gotten from neuroscience really has led me back to Harold and the Purple Crayon. So just to jog your memory, if you remember this, but you don't remember the details, or if you've never seen it, it's this wonderful book about a boy who... Here, we'll go through the first few.
One evening, after thinking it over for some time, Harold decided to go for a walk in the moonlight. There wasn't any moon, and Harold needed a moon for a walk in the moonlight. And he needed something to walk on. He made a long straight path so he wouldn't get lost. And he set off on his path, taking his big purple crayon with him. But he didn't seem to be getting anywhere on the long straight path. So he left the path for a shortcut across the field, and the moon went with him. The shortcut led right to where Harold thought a forest ought to be. He didn't want to get lost in the woods, so he made a very small forest with just one tree in it. It turned out to be an apple tree. The apples would be very tasty, Harold thought, when they got red. So he put a frightening dragon under the tree to guard the apples. It was a terribly frightening dragon. It even frightened Harold. He backed away. His hand holding the purple crayon shook. Suddenly, he realized what was happening. But by then, Harold was over his head in an ocean. He came up thinking fast, and in no time, he was climbing aboard a trim little boat.
So I would say that however complicated my paintings have gotten, they really all come back to Harold and the Purple Crayon. And this idea that you can just draw a series of lines and the lines can turn into something and create a whole world that you can enter into. So, you know, we started this morning, this talk about, you know, how my collaboration with neuroscientists and psychiatrists have really changed my projects, my whole world. And I would say that learning about the science of memory has made memory seem much more magical and exciting and hopeful to me. Because in understanding the flexibility of memory, that ability we all have to meld it with imagination has really transformed memories that I saw as dark into full of possibility and wonder. And I found myself thinking of Harold and the Purple Crayon and how when you're a kid, you have this direct access to your imagination and creating any world you want in your imagination. And you can dive into that world and anything is possible. And the science of memory has really given me that back, that sense of wonder of the mind and the power of the mind and how drawing and painting you can create an entire world that you can enter. And just the way Harold lives in a world and he makes the world he wants to be in. He needs a boat, he makes a boat. The neuroscience of memory has made me realize that I can make the world I want to live in just by using lines like Harold. I've added light and shadow because I do believe that the whole journey has been about illumination and coming out of a darkness into the light. And I think that when we're in our own private experiences of memory, especially a difficult memory, it can really feel quite dark and shadowy. And that bringing in the science of memory is a way to shine a light in the dark corners of our minds. That is the end of the presentation. And I guess I'll stop the screen share and happy to take any questions or comments.
Thank you, Viviane. I think that let Felipe comment the presentation now. Thank you so much for your presentation.
Viviane, vou falar em português.
Okay, tudo bem, yeah.
Tudo bem? Vou deixar mais natural, tá bastante gostoso aqui. Vou manter natural, tá?
Okay. You're coming in and out a little bit, Felipe, but go ahead. I'll let you know if I can't hear you something.
Tá bom. Então, vamos lá. Eu queria dizer que eu fico muito feliz de ter a oportunidade de ter te trazido para dividir isso com os meus colegas aqui do IPQ. Eu tive essa sorte de receber esse convite da Daniela Schiller, já no Brasil, aqui, ela me mandou o convite para assistir você na apresentação do Mount Sinai, quando foi feito, e eu fiquei com muita vontade de compartilhar o que eu vi com todos os meus amigos aqui do IPQ. Eu fico muito feliz que isso tenha dado certo. Eu trabalho com trauma, fiz essa pesquisa, faço psicoterapia, faço a parte clínica e fiz todo esse caminho de estudos na parte de neurociências também. A Daniela Schiller é uma neurocientista e eu também sei, e fica cada vez mais claro, e a sua apresentação me lembra muito disso, o quanto sempre haverá muitas partes dos fenômenos que a gente estuda na psiquiatria, na neurociência, que eles não podem ser completamente apreensíveis apenas por teorias ou pelo estudo do cérebro. E a arte pode permitir a gente aprender alguns aspectos que a gente não poderia de outra forma. A gente pode aprender um pouco do tom emocional, a experiência subjetiva de uma pessoa, por exemplo, uma pessoa que tem... A experiência que uma pessoa está tendo na hora que ela tem uma memória traumática vindo à tona, não tem muito... Tem parte do que a gente pode capturar pela percepção da arte que a gente não pode de outro jeito. Para a gente, especialmente a gente clínico, os psiquiatras que atuamos com pacientes, ter essa compreensão é muito, muito importante, muito fundamental. Eu acho que o seu trabalho consegue fazer a gente capturar um tanto disso de uma forma fascinante. Muito, muito bacana.
Obrigada.
Só agradeço por você ter vindo, por ter conhecido o seu trabalho. E eu fico feliz também de relembrar a sorte que eu tive de ter a Daniela Schiller como minha supervisora de pós-doutorado. Além da brilhante cientista, que é a neurocientista que ela é, existe espaço para toda essa sensibilidade, para a noção do quanto tudo isso importa. Né? Eu não sei se a gente...
I feel lucky too. I feel very lucky too that she invited there and to through you, which was actually, I have a very intact memory of Brazil, and I don't share those memories. And they're my favorite memory, special for me to with you. And yeah, very feel lucky that you came to that talk as well, Felipe.
Tivemos sorte hoje, então. Eu não sei se tem algo, se tem pergunta, Marina, você tem.
Não, a gente temos muitos elogios, mas não temos nenhuma pergunta. Vou abrir um pouquinho para a professora Reste e a professora Lipe fazerem comentários aqui, se eles desejarem.
Eu vou fazer um comentário. Mantemos em português.
Ok.
Tudo bem?
Tudo bem.
Bom, na verdade, mais do que um comentário, é um agradecimento por trazer esse conteúdo tão rico do IPQ para os nossos membros aqui dessa comunidade. E realmente achei muito interessante como muitas vezes um olhar do artista em cima de um tema tão complexo com a neurociência, a neurobiologia da memória, acaba traduzindo de uma forma muito rica, muito interessante. Eu achei muito bonito, particularmente, como você coloca às vezes as coisas em camadas, né? Uhum. E a memória de verdade é isso, é um processo associativo complexo, onde muitas vezes aquela ideia é construída e reconstruída em camadas. Da mesma forma que você pode acessar essas camadas para identificar algum elemento relacionado ao trauma,
uhum.
também é possível, vamos imaginar, na medida que as pessoas envelhecem e têm problemas de memória, esse é o caminho pelo qual nós conseguimos acessar memórias significativas, com conteúdo afetivo importante, e é um caminho para trazer algum conforto para as pessoas que não têm como construir mais a memória de uma maneira tão explícita, né?
Uhum.
Então, acho que tanto do lado da patologia quanto do lado do tratamento, esse tipo de construção é muito, muito rica, é muito interessante. Obrigado.
Muito obrigada. And I'm actually going to explore dementia and Alzheimer's also through this, because I realize you can put the animations in reverse and really show what it feels like to have everything disappear and how terrifying that is. So that's one of the stories I'm going to tell as well. So I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah.
Muito prazer em te conhecer, Viviane. Muito obrigado pelo teu investimento de tempo aqui falando para nós. E numa reunião tão rica, né, de cores, de sensações, de reflexões que você produz aqui para nós. Eu também fico impressionado, às vezes, com a possibilidade que a gente tem de interagir de uma forma multidisciplinar, né? Quanto que vocês, artistas, podem nos influenciar e ajudar a gente a desenvolver novos conceitos a partir dessa capacidade que vocês têm de representar e demonstrar, às vezes, de uma forma visível, como você faz aqui, conceitos que são muito abstratos para nós. E, ao mesmo tempo, eu fiquei com a sensação de que a tua interação com os neurocientistas, entre outros, também influenciou você na sua própria capacidade de expressar a tua arte, né? E dar um significado para a tua arte, né? Então, quanto essa interação não ajuda a gente a progredir, né? E a ciência a progredir. E quanto o olhar do artista não nos faz gerar novas hipóteses que podem ser testadas a partir também do trabalho do artista, né? Então, nesse sentido, fiquei com vontade de fazer uma pergunta, né? Você falou de reconsolidação da memória, você falou da flexibilidade da memória e a possibilidade de você preencher com imaginações que possam ter um benefício no indivíduo com uma experiência traumática, né? Fiquei com a sensação de como é que termina a história dessa tua personagem, quanto que essa experiência de reconsolidação que você propõe faz bem ou mal para ela, o que você acha disso?
Well, we don't know yet. I mean, we're in the middle of Victoria's story and my story. You know how our story ends? That's what you're asking. I hope it's been healing for her. I know that when I gave the talk at Mount Sinai, Rachel Yehuda said that, who works with a lot of veterans with trauma, that one of the biggest problems with traumatic memory is that it's not flexible, that traumatic memories are rigid, and that just by making the memory flexible, by being able to write a different story or imagine a different scenario, already frees it from being traumatic, because now the memory has become flexible. And she said, you know, in the end, it's not so much the event, but the rigidity of the memory, right? Like traumatic memories are not flexible. They can't be reinterpreted. That's the problem, right? So you stay in the loop, reliving the memory, and nothing changes, right? Over and over again. And as soon as you can change it, you know, change the direction of memory, add to it, imagine something different, that flexibility in itself, hopefully, will be freeing. I don't know if you do that, if you have used that in your work. I know people do that in narrative therapy, this whole, right?
Yes, o teu trabalho pode ser uma forma de ensinar a gente a fazer isso.
Yeah, that's true. yeah, art therapy, right? All different ways. Yeah, I would love to.
Muito obrigada, Viviane. Alguém, não sei se algum dos participantes tem algum comentário final, senão eu só agradecer muito pela apresentação, foi incrível. Acho que é muito legal a gente poder ter essa visão da arte aqui no departamento e integrar tudo isso. Muito obrigada, a gente tem muitos elogios e espero que todos tenham gostado.
Thank you so much. I want to come to Brazil as soon as all this is over and we can see each other in person. That would be great. Have a great day.
Bom, e aí, Pique, já está convidada para trazer uma nova apresentação para o Brasil.
I would love to do that. Yeah. Thank you. Muito obrigada.
Okay. Muito obrigada. Obrigada a todos pela presença. Na semana que vem teremos uma reunião de fechamento de ano e esperamos todos para poder concluir esse ano, que foi um pouco difícil para todos nós. Bom, muito obrigada e até semana que vem. Tchau. Muito obrigada. Tchau.